You're listening to Paint the Town podcast with your hosts, LA Street Art Gallery resident artist, Teachr, and founder of LA Street Art Gallery, James Chen of
What's up, bro?
Happy 420, man.
Dude, it's 420 2020. How about that? I didn't think about that until just a minute ago.
This whole month is 420, if you think about it.
Yeah. Well, it's, 420
2020. Dude, I'm excited for our next guest, man. That was a really cool conversation with Life After Death. And
some real stuff, man, you know, concerns. You know, it's funny because we would start talking a little bit more about art and stuff, but then it would go right back into, you know, the COVID-19 situation. And, you know, he was like, man, I'm sorry to, you know, put it about this, but dude, that's just, you know, that's the way it is. Like, you know, we're being artists. We have to, you know, look at what's going on right now and, you know, give our interpretation of it. So there's nothing else bigger going on than that right now. So,
you know, one of the things that I've been doing is like listening to older episodes of my favorite podcast before the whole COVID-19 thing, because like there's some episodes, let's just say of Joe Rogan or something like that, I missed, right? And then I was like, oh, you know what? I'm going to go back and listen to that, because it seems like it's like every single conversation, it always goes back, including this one right now, right? But I'm just saying, like, it's nice because there isn't that impending sense of doom basically going on, you know? And then, so I don't know. That's maybe, so if you haven't checked out every single episode of this podcast, man, it's an opportunity maybe to go back and check it out.
Plenty of time. What else you got going on, you know?
Yeah, you know, and I mean, I'm loving this Zoom thing. I'm kind of getting used to the lag of letting the guest talk, basically. And you know, it's a nice dialogue back and forth.
It's an adjusting thing, you know.
Yeah,
it's an adjusting thing.
So today we have a really special guest, right? Every single time, I mean, I always say that, but no, honestly, I think we're both pretty excited because we have a guest that's not within, let's just say the art community, for say like our normal street art community, at least, you know, but she has been.
Well, you know what? We started off interviewing graffiti artists, street artists. But then, you know, we don't want to limit ourselves. So, you know, we kind of opened it up and to people that do work in the streets, that, you know, could be photographers or whatever, but, you know, also, you know, we've opened it up to basically, you know, anybody really that has
an
had
artist.
Experiences. Even if you're not an artist, if you've had a lot of experiences with street art, if it's been a meaningful thing in your life somehow, you know, there's some amazing conversations that can be held. People can learn from this. Just ways of becoming aware of it and how to become aware of looking for street art, and how to appreciate it. Good grief. How did you get in here?
No, I let
I'm
her.
Sorry. No. My cat, I just closed the door. She was out playing in the yard and then I guess she somehow had shot inside the door before it got closed or whatever.
You need a handle real quick?
Yeah, excuse me.
Okay, I can introduce our guest real quick, okay? Basically, yeah. Our guest is the lovely Domo Monster, okay? She's my friend. She's an artist, and that's just, you know, of many kinds, basically. She's a cam girl, and she's a webcam coach. And basically, she's a huge fan of street art, and she's actually been one of Teachr's helpers before at one of her shows. You know what? I want you to explain.
Dude, not one of my very first art show, which was at Fairfax High School. Yeah, she was there. She showed up. She was very supportive. And I'll never forget that. Dude, everyone that had something to do with my first art show, I'm going to remember that for the rest of my life, you know? And,
well, there's this one thing that you had. Remember you asked me, you said, hey, James, you're a DJ. Can you find some girls for me to help me out on this one cool idea I have? And with the flashlights, basically.
Well, that's because the area where I had my artwork set up was in the Rotunda building. It is part of the original architecture of the school, and it's beautiful. You go in, and it's basically three stories high, open in the center. It had a stairway that would go up and around. And so I had my artwork up to the second level. However, the lighting was not good. And so I knew that once it got dark that first evening, it was going to be kind of hard to see things. So, you know, it was either spend money and bring in a massive lighting system and then having to get insurance for that because you got all the wires, you got to tape everything down, make it, you know, safe for the public and everything. You know, I was like, well, you know, how about this? And you're like, yeah, man, I know someone that might be able to help. And dude, sure enough, man, they showed up and they were there, man. They
showed up. It was so cool because you basically had this one wing of your art show that had, you know, the lighting wasn't too bright. And then you had like a liaison lead you up there, which were these girls who had flashlights, and then they kind of escorted you around to each piece, basically. It just added a really nice touch to your show, man. And you know what? It's funny because some people were hating on that, actually. I don't know. I mean, you know, it's funny. They felt like it was, you know, maybe not part of your brand. But hey, it's your first show, man. And you know what? You don't know. You can't tell Teach what's not part of his brand. You know what I mean? Anyways.
I understand that, though. I get that, you know, because a lot of times people see the Teach piece or the Learn Teach piece, and they've seen some of the posts that I've put up in the past and pieces I've done in the street, and it's not exactly has anything to do with teaching peace. You know, it's something that's political. It's you know, pointing out someone in particular that I've done a portrait of and you know, being really, you know, kind of harsh towards them. And, you know, that's one of the reasons why nowadays I've veered off of that path and I'm trying to do stuff that's more peaceful, you know. And
well, I think they were saying basically it's like, what are these girls with these flashlights doing? You know what I mean? Like, I just felt like it's funny, you know, because like I said, there's
certain. That's my way of being an artist.
And I thought that was super cool, man. You know,
doing the lighting. You know what I mean? So,
I happen
to be in a very, you know, much an appreciator of the female figure as an artist. You know, just the curves and everything is something I'm very appreciative of. So, and speaking of which, here we go.
Welcome, Domo.
Oh, wow.
Welcome, Domo. We can't hear you yet. You got to turn on your sound.
Yeah, there's like an audio internet thing or whatever.
Click unmute.
Man, it's okay. She's fun just to look at. Take your time. It's okay.
I think I heard something.
I wish I could help here, but I'm...
I think if you scroll on the... there is Domo's connecting audio right there.
Hello. There it goes.
Hey, yeah. There you go. I can hear you.
Can you hear us?
No. We can hear you.
We can hear you.
Okay. Hello?
Hey, yeah. Domo. How you doing?
There we go. Got it. Okay. This is my first Zoom, so excuse me.
Really?
Yeah.
Oh, wow.
Okay.
I haven't got on the rage. Everyone's talking about it, but I'm like, got a lot going on.
Welcome to the future, and thank you for making us your first Zoom. I mean, I feel honored, man.
You guys, I'm excited.
Hey, and happy 420.
Happy 420.
Yeah.
I'm able to smoke again, so It's a big holiday for me.
So I'm going to light up this joint.
You know what? I'm in my studio.
Can I get a hit of that?
Smoke, but I...
It's all right. No problem. I'm in my studio too, but, you know, it's 420. It's a holiday, man. So we got to do our thing, man.
Light it up. I got it right here, though. I had some Durban Poison, some sativa. Having that again.
Nice. Oh, shit. What's up, dude? How you doing?
Hey, what's up? Oh, so I haven't met this guy. I haven't officially met the shenanigans.
Jeeves, man. This is my...
That's right. Sorry. Market.
West Coast Jeeves, basically.
West Coast Jeeves.
You know what I mean? So he basically is my DJ partner. You know what I mean? And the reason I used to DJ with another person, but then bands break up, you know? Yeah. So good thing Jeeves jumped in and then he just was able to help me, you know what I mean? And he's my bad influence because it's funny. Most of my friends feel like
he's passing the joint back to you.
Hey, you know what? You're not following social distancing.
How
man. Like seriously, man. All right. You got to get 6 feet away from me, bro.
Oh, my God. You must have practiced that a long time. That's amazing.
You guys like that? You guys like that? Here. I think that deserves a fucking applause, man.
That's so cool. I got to meet this Steve. I have to smoke.
So, normally,
if you're just listening to the audio, man, you can always catch us on youtube.com/LA Street Art Gallery. We're actually streaming this 420 show. You can see all these shenanigans, basically, you know. So, yeah, basically, that's, you know what? The Muppet represents, like, my id, you know. It is like, all the things that, like, you know, rock stars want to do, but they're, like, horrible for them. You know, I mean, they want to party with chicks. They want to do drugs. They want to just, like, stay up all night, but you know, rock stars got to work too. You know what I mean? So you always have that bad influence friend. And the funny thing is, like, most of my friends feel like I'm that bad, or my friends' wives feel like I'm that bad influence.
The wives.
You know what I mean? So, like,
I want to go hang out at James's place.
I know.
People love to come to my place and escape their family. And you know what's funny? Because right now, this COVID-19 crisis, it's hard for people to get out. You know what I mean? Like, there's no excuse anymore. You know what I mean? Like,
people are bugging out. It's crazy. I've been, like, in social distancing for a long time, so I wasn't really tripping. But it's funny. My friends are like, oh, my God. Yeah, I got to get out of the house. You know, they got anxiety. I'm chilling. I'm like...
I was just going to ask how it's affecting you. So what has it been like?
Well, I have a daughter. I just had a baby in January. So.
Congratulations.
Welcome to the big leagues.
Yeah, this is some serious big leagues. Finally getting a balance with sleep and all that. But more so, I've been like more concerned about her. And like educating myself on like how to protect the children, also ourselves, but we've been social distancing, been staying away, mostly just go to like the grocery store and our studio. But for the most part, I mean, I could stay in. It's actually got me a creative buzz. I was really going to take this time to like take a break from everything. And then I started seeing all these like live stream. I saw that churches and schools were doing live stream, and I was like, oh my God, like I need to get back into content creating. And mainly a lot of my girlfriends are strippers and their club is closed. And I'm like been trying to tell them to get on webcam. So I'm trying to make content for them more like tutorial based so that they kind of understand the platform, how to make money. And most importantly, like stay home, social distance, like it's safe.
Let's back up for a second because I kind of want to kind of introduce you at this angle before we get into all the street art too. One of the coolest things like that Domo does is she's like a webcam model coach. Would you say that's good?
I say model and coach. Yeah.
Model and coach. Okay.
Yeah.
The cool thing is like you have like a lot of experience basically. You know, here's the thing. I'm a big fan of Joey Diaz's podcast, right? And I checked out
Joey Diaz, if you don't know, he has the Church of What's Happening Now podcast. It's real popular. He's one of Joe Rogan's friends.
Hey guys, new episode, the 420 episode, just came on today.
Oh, dude, I can't wait to check it out. You know, and it's one of my favorite ones. And Domo was on that show, basically. And, you know, it was so cool. He actually said he had an open invite whenever you wanted to come back to promote something.
Yes.
He said that you're welcome, too. You know, yes. I mean, how cool is that?
He just came out here in February, so he gave me tickets. I watched his show. I got a babysitter for the night. So it was good to catch up with him, but he's amazing. And he's been checking up on me, like, when I was pregnant and stuff, and, like, wishing me good graces. And
he's such
once
a sweet
I get back
guy.
To LA, I'll be able to go back to their studio.
So the cool thing is I really learned a lot about her business, actually, in terms of being like a webcam model, because I do. There's like my favorite Instagram models I follow on Instagram, right? And you have their Snapchat, right? But like, to be honest, it's like there's a lot of people right now. They don't have jobs anymore. And this could honestly be a outlet for them and an income source, you know? And I think a lot of people, they have no idea how to start something like this. You know, they're willing to, they always have that freaking side that they wanted to unleash, you know what I mean? And it's just like, it's pretty awesome that there's somebody that like you, that you can go to, you know?
I have been telling girls about webcam, you know, and OnlyFans and Snapchat Premium came on the map. That was like a whole other revenue. You know, there's sexting apps where you don't even have to be on camera. It's just texting. I've been telling girls to get on this before all this pandemic happened. So like, actually when it happened, I was like, oh, I'm chilling. Like, I'm good. But a lot of my girlfriends, you know, they didn't know where to start. And I was like, I have to do some type of informational content, like a resource to girls who they kind of know, but they have, you know, it really depends on them staying committed and learning through the process.
Like anything, so like any job,
it can
right?
Overwhelm girls. It's overwhelming.
Like any job.
How do they find? How do they find this? How do they find you to
well,
see
so there? You can find me on my Instagram, DomoMonster7. You can DM me. Most of the ladies I'm reaching out to. I had my content on OnlyFans. Like I didn't have it going for a while. So I was like, oh, I could bring this a platform for girls. Guys kind of swooped in there. So I'm trying to make like a Patreon and YouTube channel to make it more, you know, I don't want to give all the secrets away for free, but I still want to help girls. I'm actually coaching a few girls and guys right now during this pandemic. They're kind of asking me questions.
Can I tell you something funny? Actually, Teach used to be a stripper too.
I remember the story, like a Chippendale guy, which I can't even imagine that, to be honest.
You know, it was a few lives ago.
it's so funny because, you know what, here's the thing.
And back to Domo.
Yeah.
Hey, it's
what you noticed is that Domo's been a supporter of our podcast. She said she heard the story. I think that's the important part to take away from it, you know. And actually, the thing is, that episode actually is on the episode with one of the rappers I produced, Cali Smoov, basically, right? Yes. That you told that story. Do you remember that that time we were in Hollywood recording that episode?
Yes. Yes.
Okay, so the crazy thing is, you know what? This is how the crazy the world works, man. Okay, so I knew Domo separately just from the DJ, electronic dance music world. And then I know Cali through you, right, Teach, basically?
Right.
Okay, so, you know, we produced a few records together. And then I went down to Brazil with him, basically. And then, you know, we had an adventure down there, right? And then so we started talking about psychedelics, you know, while we were in the car one time at the taxi, right? And then he just started telling me, he was like, yeah, you know, one time I was hanging out with this girl who was an adult film actress, basically. And then I was taking acid with her for the first time. Like, I literally went crazy. And he started telling me this crazy story about, you know, how he punched somebody out because he felt like everybody was like against him, you know? And then, so I remember taking that story in and was like, oh, okay, cool. You know what I mean? All right, Cali's telling me one of these rapper stories. I expect nothing less, right? But the crazy thing is, so Domo ended up hearing the episode of our podcast and was like, dude, I mean, she didn't know that he had told me the story, basically. But basically, that adult film actress was Domo, man. How fucking small of a world is that? You know what I mean?
That was a crazy night because I had to shaman him. Like, he was kind of enjoying it, kind of freaking out, and then kind of like he would like snap out and he'd be like, oh my God, what am I doing? I need to be at the studio. What the fuck am I doing? And I had to keep like clapping his face. I'm like, hey, you're cool. Like, if you go to the studio, you're going to waste your time there. But no, it was funny. So I met Cali in Vegas at a party randomly. We stayed in touch. And when I was in LA, he hit me up one night and he was like, hey, I'm in LA. You know, what are you doing? And I was like, oh, I'm in LA too. I'm with my friends. We're going to this underground party. Do you want to go? I'm like, it's a little different. It's like electronic music. But he was down and he had friends. So we all went and I was like, yeah, you know, whatever you want to do, bring what you got and, you know, it's all good. And so, you know, whatever he brought, and me and my friends, we were taking acid. And he told me he didn't do it. So it's like, I never pushed that on people. So, you know, we're there, we're having a good time. He was really like feeling it. And like, he can tell me and my friends were on like a whole other level.
Good
and
level.
He was like, oh, he's like, what you guys doing? Like, you know, let me try it. I'm like, are you sure? And he was like, yeah, like, you know, this is cool. I feel cool. I was like, okay, you know, so I gave him a little half and it was cool. And like, he was like going in and out and then he kind of tripped out on like a couple people, but no, he was a good sport. And it was so funny at the end of the night. He was like, whoa, I did it. He's like, I've been scared of acid. I don't do that stuff. But he, you know, he found it to be really amazing after.
Yeah, that's the moral of the story. I think, you know, like I said, even though there's some crazy situations that happen, but you know what? What's crazy to me is like, I always say like acid and all these psychedelics, they find you. You don't, yeah. Like, you can look really, really hard for them sometimes, and then, you know what, you can't find them, man. But these weird situations, man, happen, and that's how I said, what are the fucking chances, man? Like, you know what I mean? I know, like, two separate people from completely different communities, and then they're telling me this story, and, but at the end of the day, like I said, I love that dude, man. You know, yeah. we've had some fucking good times, man. Shout out to fucking Cali Smoov, man.
Guys, shout out
Before we go any further, I just wanted to say, Domo, thank you so much for being at my first art show. We were just talking about that earlier before you came on, and that meant the world to me. Anyone that was involved in my very first art show, I'm going to remember that for the rest of my life. So I just want to say thank you so much for being there, for showing up and just doing what you were, you know, asked to do and doing an amazing job and making it memorable. Thank you.
Dude. No, thank you. And thank you to Sue. She was the one who hooked me up
with that. Shout out to Sue
Momo. Called me last minute. But I didn't know that was your first. I had no expectations. I was like, oh, whatever. It's like some artist. But when I went, I was blown away. I was like, whoa. I was like, this type of art is way too cool for just the Fairfax High School. Like, this is some other shit. And I just, you know, I felt compelled to like tell other people, help in any type of way. Yes. I remember I met your wife I'm all about street art and art and creativity. So that was an amazing experience.
Dude, that's, you know what? It was so cool that, you know, you brought some other girls. Shout out to those girls too, that, you know, came out and helped out, man. You know, and you know, I thought it was really cool because that night you got to meet some other street artists too, right? And then,
yeah, you know, that was the first time I met. And you know, what's crazy out of that show, So I was blown away, right? I go to my car, and there was a letter on a little note on my car from another street artist. Yeah. And I'm really, really sorry. I forget his name. I was trying to like look back at my text.
Bandit?
Yeah, Bandit. Okay. Oh my God, yes. Okay, so he had this message, and it was like, oh, call this number, mansion party next week, you know, whatever. So that was like my first time kind of getting involved in the street art, like the actual people. And I was like, oh my God, I got to go to this mansion party. I got to check it out. I liked how he did the promotion. I hit him up, you know, followed the little rules. And he hit me back and he was like, oh, you know what? Party fell through. We don't have a location, working on it, blah, blah, blah. And I was just like, okay. I was like, well, you know.
That also happens a lot in the street art.
I don't know what happened. I just started to talk to him and he was like, I was like, yeah, I love, you know, street art and, you know, to go bombing. And then he invited me and I was a little nervous. I was like, oh fuck, like I was like, okay, let's do it. I didn't meet him, I didn't know what he looked like, I didn't know who I was going to. And so I met him and he asked me to like assist him, be the lookout. It was like totally adrenaline rushing, but it was a little scary at the time, but it was cool. And then he asked me to do this. He was doing a piece on a strip club in Chinatown, Chinatown. And I was like, all right, yeah, I'll go. And, yeah, that was like the craziest experience, but it was cool. And I started to like meet more of the street artists and stuff. And, that was really cool. So that is right what now. Your first gallery show, got me.
Awesome. That's awesome, man.
Yeah, how cool is that? I'm just saying, it's just Teach. You're basically bringing a lot of people together at the end of the day. You know what I mean? And yeah, your show seems like so long time ago if you think about it.
It was
4 years ago. That was 4 years ago.
That was a long time ago.
Was this the day that you went out, basically?
No. So that was another
street artist
crew. So this was like a long time ago. We did this shoot. They actually spell Onyx. That was for my, you know, my webcam stuff. These guys were really cool. I shot with them. We had a little falling out, but I still kept the, you know, the content and stuff. Yeah, but that was really cool. They did a whole piece and we did a shoot and then they got me the spray can, and they were just like, yeah, just spray it. And
that's really awesome. So
it was cool. Another awesome street artist guys in LA, but I did street art one time. So my favorite movie is this documentary called Primer on, you know, urban art. I saw it on Netflix one day after school and started making stencils over in Hollywood. And I went to 7-Eleven and like the cops weren't there. Like it's usually like packed. And so then me and my friend were like, fuck, this is the moment. And so we went, we got our stencils. We didn't know what the fuck we were doing. And I made this little Domo character and I put my name and I spray painted it on my building and it like lasted like 4 weeks.
And then wow.
So I was proud. It was so scary. It was like during the day, like kind of nobody would notice, but that was my little.
A lot of times that's the best time to go is during the day. And if you know, you can just make it look like you're doing what you're doing. that was so cool.
Yeah, I was over off of Vine, but on the 101 freeway. When I lived over there, I felt the moment. I was like so into all these like street art documentaries.
Dude, that's like, so cool.
Picture of that.
So, dude,
welcome
I mean,
to the community. You're now a vandal.
Yes. Yeah. So, and that's how I got involved with Franklin too, from you guys. But I loved his podcast. I loved listening to you guys, and then just reached out to him and I was like, yo, bro, like, if you ever need somebody to assist you, let me know. And he was like, oh my God, like, we should make content. I'm like, I'm down, let's do it.
You know what? It's so funny because, like, that's Franklin's awesome. Whole I thing Franklin. I love that guy too. His whole thing, man, like, you know, you and Truth both reached out to, Truth is another, you know, beautiful, beautiful woman, man, reach out to him, man, because of his podcast, man. And he's sitting there thinking, like, when can I lose my virginity, man? When can I actually.
It was, when I was listening to him, I was like, does this guy really talk like this? Like, I was like, this is not just a normal guy. And then when I saw his Instagram, I was like, oh my God, I've seen that fucking face around LA. This is the fucking person. Like, it was actually like, it was amazing. Cause I was like, yes. Oh, there it is. I've seen him around town.
that's what I'm saying, like, the power of street art. You know, if you've been, like, in, you know, Hollywood, whether you're like a DJ, whether you're a dancer, or you're just a party goer, man, you know, you've probably seen Franklin Stencil on the floor. If you went to Amoeba Records, you know what I mean, it's like
everywhere.
There's just, like, you know, even there's people like Thrashbird, you see his stencil everywhere, so of yes. course you know who he is. You know what I mean? Phone.
I you know what's funny about street art was I first moved to LA. And my car, I fucking totaled it, right? And then the subway was there. And I was like, okay. So I was walking around all over LA at a time. I would see street art. And this was when Instagram wasn't super big. I would just snap a picture because I was like, oh, that's cool. And then I'd post it. Didn't know who the artist was. Some random person would tag in the artist. And I was like, oh, my God. Now I know who this fucking name is. Like, oh my God, that's cool. And it was just like these little random people would tag the name of the artist. And it was cool. It was like a little community, but like a mysterious. Yeah,
exactly. And now you're part of it. Now, and I mean, you were already part of it, but that's why we wanted to invite you on the show, honestly, because she has so many cool, creative things going on, man. I mean, I went to her studio in Vegas. I mean, I mentioned earlier, she was on the Joey Diaz show. She's also a regular guest on Shade 45. Tell us yes. a little bit about it, because I'm not, I mean, I know, you know, it's Eminem stuff, right? But what is it?
So I have a sweet spot for nerds, okay? Like, one of my favorite movies is Revenge of the Nerds. This guy, so I had it in my car, I had Sirius going on in the car, and they were making fun of them. And I'm friends with some of the Eminem camp. And so, you know, Sirius, Shade 45, that's the station. They were making fun of this guy, John, the producer. Mm-hmm. And it was his birthday. They were like, oh, yeah, we're going to get you a hooker, but maybe not. And so I was like, they were teasing him. I was like, you know what? I'm going to hit him up. And I'm in L.A. I'll smoke you out. And then so I just reached out. And then they hit me back on the All Out Instagram page. And they gave me John's number. And I told him, I told him to meet me at this cafe in LA, and it's like mysterious. It has like a treehouse type of thing. So I made it all secret, and the guy met me. We smoked a joint. It was his birthday. We chatted, and then they asked me to go on the show. And I was like, oh yeah, whatever. From there, it just blew up. So I mean, there's a lot of people on my Instagram. They follow me. So I helped John get bitches. I take him shopping. I help him get the girls, get him attention. So it's crazy. It's hilarious.
She's like a coach in a lot of ways, man. I mean, she does the webcam modeling coaching, right? But she also teaches. That's what I'm saying, man. Like, I
what a sweetheart.
I feel like Franklin, man, he doesn't want to lose his virginity, man. That's like his thing. You know, I mean, because once he loses his virginity, he's just like, dude, there's nothing like, you know what I mean? He has to come out of the act, basically.
You know, but he's got to savor the innocence. The innocence is great. It's very, it's hilarious. But
well, imagination is always going to be better than the reality.
Exactly.
You know
what I mean?
So, exactly. You know, I think he might be able to hold on to that for the rest of his life.
I've been watching.
We have a fun time. And it was funny when I came to do, like, I did an interview with him for his social media. I had all this weed. He doesn't smoke weed. And I was like, oh. I'm like, so you're just like that. Yep. I love him and Cyrus. They are awesome guys.
Yeah, shout out to you guys. You know what? And they recently broke like 10,000 on TikTok without even like buying any followers, man. So shout out to them, man. Seriously.
No, when Franklin got his Instagram taken down and there's all this bullshit, he was telling me about his mission to go on TikTok. And so I'm really proud of them to keep going. When mine got deleted from my other page, I just was like, fuck it. It's too much energy.
Oh, man. No kidding.
Too many things going on nowadays. But you know, that's what I love about podcasting too. Cause honestly, it's like if someone hears your podcast, they either love you or they hate you, or, they subscribe, and there's no like algorithm that controls how many views, you know. Once you subscribe, you see all the episodes, and it's like, hey, it's your choice if you want to download it, you know? And I don't know. Yeah. I think podcasting is like one of the last like free, ways to social
ad free.
Yeah, you know what I mean? It's like
ad-free, algorithm-free, yeah.
Exactly.
And it's just, you could talk about whatever, like, we just launched our podcast, but we had technical issues, but that's why I was just like, you know what, fuck it. Like, even if we have tech issues, let's just do it. Let's just get on. And we'll learn little by little. So yesterday, we were like, oh, fuck. We didn't have this, but we had half of it. So now we're going to go on. But we're just like practicing and just kind of like keeping it going. It's like a new hobby.
Yeah, you know, and also it's like I seriously remember when Rogan was doing his first few episodes. It wasn't even called the Joe Rogan Experience yet. It was called the Joe Show, actually. You know, and the thing is like basically, you know, there was – he had snowflakes coming down the ceiling. He basically just, you know, he was just sitting in front of the computer talking, man. And now he's having people like Bernie Sanders on, you know, I mean, on the show, man, like, you know, presidential candidates. How crazy is that, man?
Rogan's show is fucking crazy. And it's, I watch it all the time. I love the guests that he puts on, and so informative. And I think he really helped Joey get himself on the map, and Joey did a lot of trial and error, but man, there's a lot of great podcasts, and it's good to just kind of change things up from like watching the news, TV, and all, like, you know, even the radio. I don't really listen to the radio, so I love podcasts, and I love the whole connecting. I love all this like live stream connections, getting out to the world. I think that's fucking cool.
Yeah, definitely. Yeah,
it's a good safe way of doing it too.
Exactly.
Yeah, you know,
we got
social
distance now. That's the thing.
Do you think, okay, you know, one of the things that we know each other from is like raving, basically, you know, like, you know, there's the biggest festivals out. Wait, can we back up for a second? Because you said you moved to LA. I totally thought you were from LA. Where are you originally from?
I'm from Riverside, actually. Okay. I don't know if you guys know where Riverside is. It's Inland Empire. It's kind of like on your way to Vegas.
I've had people tell me they're from LA if they're from Riverside. You know what I mean?
No, I know. People do that. I am legit. I love my Riverside. I love where
I'm 909 straight up.
It's very home. Like, it's home. So, and it's way different from LA. But yep. LA is another home. I moved to LA when I was like 21. So it took me a while to get there. I would go visit all the time. And then I just recently moved out, which was really sad. But I'll be back, you know, when you have a baby, you can't be going back and forth. So, LA is just...
It's really, you know, it's so expensive to live here now, right?
Exactly. I had an awesome place. My rent was not that bad, but I had two places. I had Vegas place and an LA place, and I just had to
So you would go back and forth and go-go dance basically at the club.
I would. So I used to, I'm very involved in like promo model gigs and go-go dancing and all the hustle out here in Cali. And when that started to like slow up, I started dancing in Vegas. And Vegas is just amazing. But I also have my studio. So I have my own webcam studio, kind of, you know, also like a media service because I don't have just cam room. And we were setting up a podcast. And so I really wanted to focus on getting a podcast because I think that's cool. And it's different from, you know, my OnlyFans and my camming. I like to be myself, you know, Domo. I like to be involved in like cannabis, the art community, you know, helping girls. And plus the music scene, like,
that's what, you know what,
jumping off right now.
Yeah, the music scene's going to be tough for a while unless you're just writing, you know. Honestly, but it's going to be hard to make money.
And I don't know if you've been following them. They've been doing these virtual rave-a-thons, which is really cool. And it's, like, family-friendly because now people can kind of, like, rave with their children. They get a little taste of that. So I think that's incredible. Plus, they are, you know, their equipment is, like, top-notch.
Yeah.
So streaming is like on point. And it's just cool.
Yeah. I mean, you know what? I think it's kind of, it's definitely really cool that they're kind of holding it together. Going back to what she's saying is that a lot of DJs have been doing virtual festivals as they're basically just DJing in front of on the TV. And it kind of just looks, if you turn off the lights, it almost looks like the DJ is like right there, you know?
Yeah.
But I think the thing is like they used to make, how much money per ticket, you know what I mean? Per person when going to the festival, I don't think they're going to get that much money.
I don't think they're going to get that much money. I know that they're getting some type of revenue, but I think right now it's just, even though this is exploding, there's still some kind of like figuring out to do, to like understand how to make this money, but then also connecting directly with the fans and trying to create experience. Like, we're actually planning to do a virtual little concert type of same thing, just a little different. We want to bring some kind of like music event vibe to Vegas. It's not really out here, you know. If you come out to Vegas and you see the DJs set different from like LA or New York, or it's not the same. Vegas is like it's a Vegas, it's
more clubby
set. So there's not really like a music vibe, like it's not really a music community. So that's what we're trying to bring, and get creative people and, you know, just try this whole thing out, because I'm really inspired by what Insomniac's doing with their virtual rave-a-thons, and I think it's just dope.
Yeah definitely. Fun. I mean, you know, though, but like some people, like stand-up comedians, it's kind of hard for them to tell jokes like to the screen, right? It doesn't really work.
I don't think
the audience feedback, you know.
There's definitely some industry, some, you know, careers you can't live stream. You can't really connect that way. It sucks, but I think that's also kind of cool that we still have like a little, you know, we have some sort of humanity in us that it's, you know, we could tell that it's not the same, and we should just try to still stick it to being in there with humans. Like this whole situation, I think it's really weird, and I think it's kind of crazy to see like when life will go back to normal, and I don't think it is anytime soon.
No, I find it interesting watching on YouTube the talk show hosts. I never really watched their shows. I just watch clips from their shows on YouTube.
Yeah.
And, you know, guys like Steve Colbert and the guy with The Daily Show, the black guy, Noah.
I know what you're talking about.
Seth Rogen. And, you know, watching how they're dealing with doing it from home now, you know, with their family around, no audience and everything. It's been interesting watching it first when they started doing it. You know, they were just, it was hard. It was, but now some of them are getting, you know, they're getting with it, you know, and it's going to be interesting seeing them once eventually it does get, it's never going to be back to the same it was before, but what the new normal is going to be, you know, they're going to have audiences and everything, but I'm just curious to see what it's going to be like for them going from that home situation that it's going to be months. It's going to be months that they're going to be doing it like that, to go from that back to having a live audience. I mean, yeah. It must be like going on steroids or something when they come back to the live audience, to actually have that energy back, you know?
It's, yeah, it's a lot of adapting too, which is also kind of the cool part, because it kind of makes you think like this is going down in history. You know, years from now, we're going to be like, oh yeah, you remember that 2020 time? Like that, I think that's kind of the crazy part, and just figuring all this out. The youngsters, they are definitely ahead of the game as far as how to connect all this technology, yeah. How to have the time. But, you know, a lot of old heads, I just think it's awesome. It's a big creative surge going on for everybody. And it's kind of like, if you're not hopping on this wagon, like, you're going to be left behind from whatever life used to be.
This is one of those great culling of the herds moments. You know, there's going to be Pete, it's going to make a man or a mice out of you. You know, there's going to be people that are going to step up and be great, because it takes moments like this to make great people. Mm-hmm. You know, you don't get great people out of just normal everyday things going on. It one of the things I've been like this to, you know, to make great people.
One of the things I've been saying is that it's kind of interesting. If you're a bedroom DJ, let's just say, right, or you're a singer songwriter, right? All of a sudden, man, hey, the playing field has been leveled. You're on the same fucking level if you're Diplo or if you're a bedroom DJ that just started off. You're all DJing to your fucking Instagram right now. You know what I mean? Have you ever thought about that? Okay.
I like that. What kind of opportunities
are you created? Like, this is a once in a lifetime chance. You know what I mean? Now you're on the same fucking, yeah, these other people have platforms. Yeah, they're more popular now. But I'm just saying, there's some people literally still waiting for their fucking $600 check. Yeah. You know what I mean? Like, doing nothing. Okay. So I'm just saying, if you're listening out there, man, if you're an artist, this is your time to build, man. Okay. You know, this is your time to build a platform. You don't have a platform, build a fucking platform. Nah. You know, start a podcast, man. Get your friends on, because everybody's Zoom conferencing. There's going to be content, you know.
Yeah.
And to be honest, you know, the people who still have income and that are still surviving, we're very blessed, you know. But I'm inspired, man, because I'm just, you know how I'm doing that? I'm avoiding the news. I don't open CNN, period, because it's like they're selling clicks, you know.
Fake news.
Yeah, they're selling.
I wish it was fake.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, the COVID is not fake. You know, right? Yeah, but you know, every single day there's things that change, you know. And if you just want to be doom scrolling on your phone, just scrolling news, bad news. That's a new term they had to add in the dictionary this year.
Oh, really?
Doom scrolling, basically. Yeah.
I ain't gonna lie. In the beginning, I was definitely on it. I don't like watching news, but I felt for this, I had to like tune in, and I just had to stop. Like it's depressing, and so that's why I saw churches and schools were trying to learn how to live stream. And I'm like, what in the fuck? I'm like, camming was like made for this. And so when I saw a lot of girls are like tripping, and it's like, yo, bitches, like, yeah, I've been telling you, we got to change the hustle, like do it smarter, do it like, I hustled so much before, like I had my baby, that I was good and chilling. And I'm like trying to help girls get on the same level. Like you have multiple forms of income coming in, be creative, grow a platform, connect with people. But you know, don't stress. Like, there's so many opportunities to make money, and, you know, it doesn't have to be camming. Like, it could be any type of
also content. I think what's kind of cool that you mentioned on Joey Diaz's episode, that one of the things, it really empowers women. I think that it, like, hey, what do you do, whatever you're comfortable with, actually, right? Yeah. Basically, you know, and if you're in like the porn world, you kind of get pushed into like, hey, do this, do that, you know what I mean? And it's kind of just, they kind of like just eat girls it and spit them out, basically, you know what I mean? Like, I think, right? So can you talk a little bit about that? Because I thought that was really cool how you were talking about.
Yeah, I joined the industry, but I have like a strong mentality. When I went in, I didn't know I was going to meet what the other girls were going to be like. And there was a lot of young girls. There was, you know, girls that were my age that didn't have that confidence, and they were kind of doing something that they didn't want to. And that's when I found camming. Like, I went to a party, and I wasn't camming at this time. I was still doing my go-go dancing stuff. I went to a party, and these girls were camming. They're from New York. And we were like with them, they were making money from this home. And they're like, yeah, this is what we do. Like, this is how we live. We just do this. And from that moment on, I was like, wait, hold up. I'm fucking doing a gig, 4 hours, $100, dancing my fucking ass off. And I'm struggling to make sure I get all these residencies. But you're at home with your girlfriend making money doing like not even close of the burning energy like how I am. And I was like, oh, I got to go in on this because, you know, I have a lot of girls that were go-go dancers and they were trying to find money. But I'm very protective with my girls. I want to make sure that they're not, they can do this at their comfort levels. You know, they don't have to rely on an agency, a man. You know, they can
like
just
some guys like they don't even want to see girls naked, they just want to like watch them eat or something like that, right?
Dude, fetish is huge. I recommend it because sometimes you will just be doing something that has nothing to do with sexual energy, whatever. If they're getting turned on from it, you're not seeing what they're doing, but you're, you know, you're benefiting with money. But it's like a two-way street. They're happy, you make whatever the fuck that they want to see, but you set the boundaries. I mean, like, what more can you ask for?
I feel like DJs and cam girls actually now have a lot in common these days, because we're all like just on the camera, and then people are like tipping us money basically if we're doing the live stream, you know.
Yeah,
I mean, you know what? I just want to say something to those out there that have a problem with this. You know, prostitution is one of the oldest businesses in America. Okay, and
sex work, right?
Yeah, and you know, this is probably the safest form of it. They have gone. They found a way to make it safe. And, you know, I don't know, if you're going to hate on that, then you're one of the small percentage of people that just, you know, that aren't sexual at all and have no understanding or appreciation for it. And it's hard for me to fathom that, but, you know, there are people out there like that. And, you know, what people have to understand is that, you know, if they're hearing some kind of, you know, throwback from it or something, then it's probably that small percentage of people that, you know, are going to have a problem with just about everything.
It's always, you know, the guy that the preacher that's preaching against homosexuality who gets caught with the prostitute, the guy prostitute smoking meth.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. So I think, you know, it's what I think is cool, especially even before this COVID crisis, literally what Teach said, it's like, hey, girls can be, or guys, they can be as comfortable as they want to. Like, let's just say you're, you know, I know a dude, actually, he's a gamer. He plays on Twitch, basically. But all the people tipping him money, they're tipping him money because they like, they're just creepy. So they're creepy old dudes. Like, actually, yeah. I mean, he tells me, but I'm sure for a prettier person, like, you know, it'd be less creepy. It's like, just a lot...
This is the time to appreciate those creepy old fucks. And you know what? Creepy young fucks too. Like it really
tell you something. These creepy old fucks, it just depends on who you are as to who they are, okay? You might be a creepy old fuck yourself.
And sometimes it's beneficial. This guy, he loves heels. He buys me expensive heels. All he wants is pictures in the heels and for me to talk shit to him. Sure, why not? Buy it.
It's so funny because
bring the tap up. I'm with it. Oh, you want me to tell you, like, you know, there it is. There's ranges. There's feet. There's
Guy that just wants you to tell how ugly his dick is. You know what I mean? Like, yeah. Like that, right? That's what I heard on that podcast, man. Like, it's so crazy.
It really took me a while to like get into it. I really had to do a lot of like trial and error doing it. But by the time, you know, I'm an actress, I have to act these things because I really don't want to tell people that they're shithead and they're useless. But if it makes them happy and enjoyable, I'll do that.
You're not hurting anybody, right? You know what I mean?
I'm not killing nobody, and I'm not telling him to leave his wife or his girlfriend or whatever.
Or he's just lonely and he has no wife or girlfriend too.
They are so happy. These guys, they even stuck around that I was pregnant. I let them know I'm taking a break, and they're so happy to just kind of be there. I still reach out and say, I hope you're having an awesome day. And, you know, they come around, they help me pay my bills. They help me live a life that, you know, where I don't need to go to the club. I don't need to go work a job. Like, I got it right here. It's still work. I put time and effort into my content, into editing and to timing, getting it out.
Who would have ever thought that your work that you're doing now is safer than a doctor or a nurse?
Oh my God, I know. And you know, I feel for these people who are in the front lines, I really do. But I'm also like, girls, stop tripping. Maybe you get that stimulus check, whatever. Fucking do this, you'll get
money right
away. Like, don't wait for this.
You know what? I want to bring this up also. David mentioned this in the last episode. You know, there's one blanket amount for everybody, one stimulus check amount for everybody. And it's, you know, it should be dependent upon kind of where they live and what they pay for rent. Because he made the point that, you know, rent in California, as opposed to rent, you know, so almost anywhere, not anywhere else, but, you know, up in Oregon or something like that, you know, he knows someone that's paying $400 a month. You know, meanwhile, you got someone else that's paying $1,200 a month. So yeah. What do you think about that?
I honestly, sounds like it's some bullshit wrapped in a bow, you know, sounds nice. Oh my God, we're going to get like, let's be real. How long is it going to take for us to get that? And we have to keep in mind, you know, I really feel for mothers, like diapers and all this shit. It adds up. And you also got to have food on the table. By the time you get that check, you're going to be battling if you got an eviction, you know, if this guy, because if you don't pay your rent, then that landlord can't get his mortgage paid or whatever. You know, it's like a system. And to be real, sure, take the steps to get the stimulus check, but also like start looking for something to do. Joey always says, go to the grocery stores, try to find a job, you know, try to, you know, get online, find a new hustle, but like,
delivery. A lot of companies are looking for people to deliver. You know, if you can deliver, that's one thing.
And it's horrible too. Like the banks, like any families who have negative accounts, and if the
when it was direct deposited, they took it right out. Oh yeah.
I saw that in the New York Post, and like that's really serious. Like, you know, this money could be a blessing, and it could also, you know, just
not even help. Yeah.
Steve Mnuchin, that son of a bitch. the Secretary of Treasury was encouraging people to, you know, do the direct deposit because they'll get the money quicker instead of having the checks mailed to them. Yeah. That son of a bitch, because if it's direct deposited, that's benefiting the big banks, because if there's any money owed or anything, they just take it right out. And so they never even see the money.
And there are so many families who don't use banks. And, like, you know, a lot of our international people, like, some of them, they're old school. They don't do banks. They don't even know how this direct deposit shit works.
A lot of sex workers, right? They don't use banks either.
Oh, no, we use banks. We use our banks. Our banks are set. It's good. But, you know, this is really an eye-opener to, I hope it's not a conspiracy of, you know, where this money's coming from. I had to take a break from watching all those conspiracy theories, but it's
too many.
Well, you know, here's the other thing, okay? It's just a one-time check, you know?
Yeah.
In other countries, they're getting that much every month. Like, in Germany, I think it's something like $7,800 they're getting every month, okay? This is just a one-time fucking thing here.
And the question is, okay, so there's talks that this may extend to 2021, 2022. What are we going to do past that one check? You know, like, I don't think people are really thinking about that. And
according to Steve Mnuchin, he was saying, they're interviewing, was saying, well, so how long is this supposed to last? You know, like a month or whatever? He goes, well, no, it's supposed to be, you know, 10 weeks. The $1,200 for 10 weeks. Okay, maybe that'll last you for 10 weeks if you live somewhere in Nebraska, you know, by yourself. But I live here in L.A., and I got twin nine-year-olds that I'm homeschooling now. And, you know, rent is $700-$800 a month. So,
what do you do? I mean, it is almost like it's hard to watch what our government is doing, because you're just like, what the fuck is going on? Can anybody get it together? So that's why I'm like, I'm not even looking. I'm still being aware of what's going on, but it all sounds like a crock of fucking shit. And if you rely on them, you're just an idiot. You need to get on your own and figure something out, because, you know, hustlers, they're flipping the mask. They're trying to get the gloves out. They're trying. The hustle still goes on in so many ways. And I hope a lot of families are get through the hard times. This is really hard and totally like unreal that this is the history that we're making in 2020.
Yeah, I mean, I could just see it now in the history books of everybody making the masks. That's going to be the stock picture. You know what I mean? The thing is, like, you know what, again though, I just want to pretty much stress to the audience, man, like, you are now, if you're a DJ, you're now level playing field with Diplo, man. Okay, I was watching his you know, live stream with Dylan Francis, DJ, man, killing it online. And I'm thinking, like, hey, man, you know, what am I going to do for my brand to use this time wisely? You know what I mean? Are you going to just freak out at home, man? Or, you know, this is the perfect time to create art, man. Like, I hate right now, I really, really hate seeing, you know what, there's so many Instagram models that are like, throwback Thursday last year, I was here, you know, because they need attention and they have nothing to post. That's their whole personality.
Oh girl, the nails, all the girls, I got no nails on, but girls are, we're struggling. The hair, I might get my hair guy, we're talking, I might get a haircut, but for the most part, they're posting. And you know, also, it's like, this is the time to get creative. The booty pics, we got it, okay? You need to be a little real. Maybe a booty pic with the mask, some gloves, maybe some protective gear. You know, like, the content has to change. We're not in the Bahamas chilling.
Oh man, like, I've been seeing some really, really good mask pictures, man. Let me pull one up. I mean, you know, basically. Oh man,
I can't. Whatever. I bought some goggles. So,
so let me ask you, is there any, right now you're not doing any camming stuff, are you?
No.
I was just wondering if you had any like COVID, like masks, like fetish stuff going on, you know?
Oh, so I had this latex mask that I always was like, why the
heck? Damn it.
But for the most part, I'm going to get creative with the protective gear. Oh, shit. But my nanny was like, oh, you should get some goggles because, you know, it could get in the eyes. I'm like, fuck yeah, I'm going to order these goggles and I'm going to take some dope pics in it. You know, just kind of bring
them. I've been seeing some really good, nice content with the mask, yeah. Like this kind of stuff. You know what I mean?
Because you're really going to be protected in the thong.
The thong is made out of masks. That's the thing.
I think the mask is more material than the outfit, but you know what? She gets an A for effort. She's doing.
Yeah, exactly. That's what I'm saying. Like, you know, you're really starting to see who has a personality on Instagram and who's just living in the past and just like hoping for shit to come back normal, man. You know, I mean, like in the event. Industry like festivals and things like that, like those aren't coming back anytime soon, man. Like they really, really aren't, man.
Crowds, anything that has big crowds, man. Nope.
I can't.
Sports people are like, oh, we're gonna get back to it. And I'm like, like even the casinos out here, once they open those casinos, I ain't going. That's gonna be where an outbreak happens. So I'm staying clear of that. But it's funny, people on the Insomniac thing, they're just like, we can handle it, just let us go. And it's like, it takes one person to sneeze, cough on you, and then boom.
Like, you know, raves are just like a cesspool breeding ground for disease, man. People are so dirty, and things like, you know, it's not, at the end of the day right now, it's really about what business is really willing to take the liability of an outbreak happening and then the business getting sued and then getting shut down. That's basically what it comes down to at the end of the day. There's no business that's going to be willing to take that risk. You know, if you're an event company. So, I mean, there may
Dana
be
White,
like...
Dana White with UFC, he was trying to get that fight going.
Now, who would have thought of all the sports businesses that the WWE would be the first one going again?
Thanks,
Florida.
A crock of shit. And like Vince McMahon is like on the committee. Like, what in the world? What are we going to? Like, these celebrities need to get out of government. Like, it's just, it's so embarrassing. And it's like, where are we going to? Like, when is someone going to say we're punked? Because I'm ready. It's like every day. First, we thought Trump was it, and it's a circus.
Going,
it's literally a circus. I feel like we're in a video game, and the scary boss guy, like that's Trump, and like we don't know what's gonna happen. Like it just feels weird. So that's.
I love how you put it right there. You know, like. What I love is, like, you know, there's actually people arguing that wrestling's real still, and they're like, yes, it's back. You know what I mean?
Ronda Rousey left that shit. She said, fuck this shit. It's not worth it. She was on Steve-O's podcast. It was actually really funny. But she's like, fuck these fans. I guess the fans weren't showing her love, but she's like, guys, this is not real. Like, we really choreographed this shit. But yeah, I mean, that was so controversial, but it's like, really, like in the time of the pandemic, you think this is going to help us?
It's like, it's funny because it's the only bullshit sport. I mean, you know, at least the one that we know, it's just
Trump
like
talks about fake news. Well, this
yeah,
is...
yeah, exactly. It's like, yeah. They want everything presented to you to be fake, but back to
what I was saying, that's 11 playing field. If you have a media outlet, man, now, hey, check this out. If you're doing the Daily Show and you're doing this show, man, we literally, it's like we're doing the same thing, man. We're just talking about amongst our community, you know? Yes. So I would really love everybody who's watching this to share it, man. I mean, me and Domo have a lot of mutual friends, man. Shout out to all of our mutual friends. You know who you are, man. So, and you know what? It's like, please support the podcast, man. Share it with your friends, man. And, you know, if you want to come on and hang out and talk about street art or what you're doing creatively, man, we'd love that, man. And I love this crossover right here because I know you have your show coming up. I want to promote that, right? So yes. Where can we find your show?
So Green Room Radio on IG, and then thegreenroom.com will link you to our YouTube channel. And bear with us, we're still trying to set things up, but we got two shows, so we're recording. We just did our 420 show yesterday, so it'll be episode 2. We'll be posting the recordings on for YouTube, and very soon we will be doing some live stream virtual kind of streaming shows with artists, DJs, music guests, hip-hop guys, and bringing some influencers.
Nice.
On. So lots in store. Trying to learn all this fucking technology.
Who do you do your show with? Give them a shout out.
Shout out to True Management and DJ DeVille, one of the number one remix guys in the business. So we have all come together. We're from different walks of life. True used to be a tour manager for Eminem. Still kind of is involved with that community. So he comes from that area. DeVille comes from the electronic world. He's a producer. He works with a lot of big guys.
Yeah, I'd love to do a collab with him, man.
They buy his remixes and they play it like Diplo and Skrillex. And
dude, I'd love to have him on the show, man, and talk a little bit of DJ stuff.
Yes, you gotta have these guys. These are some real cool guys. And collectively, we know a lot of people, so we're going to have a lot of guests come in. You know, we're totally going to get in with weed sponsors. We have a lot of people in the works, and we just really want to bring, like, the real underground to Vegas. There isn't really, like, a scene here.
We'll send some street artists your way, too.
People. So, yes, and please send some stickers, send some art that we can hang in our studio.
Shout out to She Killed Me First, You shot me first.
You killed me. Shout out to Cult 33, actually, right? She is, and You Killed Me First, man. We should have them on, and then, like I said,
and Snipped as well is in there.
Yeah, we gotta have the other members of Cult 33 because they're out there in Vegas. They're in the marijuana industry too.
Totally link us. You know, we get it started, we will totally love to feature any street artists. You know, just ask them about their world, see what they're doing. Any artists that you guys have on,
awesome.
Bring it our way, and any art stickers and stuff sent our way so we can put it up in our studio.
Yeah, I love that. She has like a nice Franklin sticker, framed on the wall, man. Signed,
dude. I have Franklin on the wall right there, and then I have another one in the front. So I got him. So I got to get you guys in here, but yes, he sent me a postcard. I have it hanging, and he gave me all these stickers. Yes. Give me that so I can hang that up for you guys.
Love for you guys to be like our sister show, man. You know, as you guys are getting started, basically. Like, build a little network among us. I know other people are starting shows, and we should all just have each other as guests on. And, you know, because the dynamic is always different whenever you're with different people, basically.
We need, you know, there has to be collab. And also, you know, we reach out, you know, the street art world, that's a whole different world. I love it, and I'd love to tap into those people. I'd love to learn about these artists, of who they are. You know, that's why I really like your guys' show, because you guys are talking to these artists, and these are like mystery people, and to hear their side is actually really cool. I dig it, because I'm like, oh my God, I know that art, and it's really cool to hear who that person is and, you know, what they're doing to stay connected. Like, I think that's super dope. And we totally support you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. So anyways, guys, check out her show,
Green Room Radio or the Green Room Radio.com.
No, the greenroomradio.com. Yeah.
Sorry about that. And yeah, you know, like I said, we're going to support you and promote your stuff. Okay. So, where can we find you? Where's your, what's your Instagram?
Find me on IG, DomoMonster7. I'm on Snapchat too. Hit me up, DM me.
Make some money.
Our podcast, Green Room Radio. Yeah. If you want to get in on my OnlyFans, hit me up. Girls, if you want to learn how to hustle online, hit me up. I got you. And guys, I will work with everybody. but thank you guys so much. Really appreciate you guys having me on. And happy 420.
Thank you so much for coming on the show. Appreciate it.
Yes. And when this is all cleared up and you guys come to Vegas, you guys got a spot to come through.
Hell yeah. Awesome. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Bye. Awesome. Take care.
Bye, guys.
Enough. Peace.
Peace.
And in